My name's Justin. This is my first video I've ever made. I've been sort of hesitant to make it, but I figure now it's about time. I have a bit of a story to tell first. About 9-10 years ago, I didn't care about religion, anything spiritual, really anything at all. And I found myself night after night staring up at the stars, thinking there's got to be more. You know, every town you go to, you got McDonald's, Burger King, you got a mall, bowling alley, movie theater, bars, clubs, and that's, you know, you're going to have that same sort of theme besides some different architecture throughout the world. It's pretty much the same routine. I just would look up at the stars and think to myself, this can't be it. And as I would do that, throughout the years, I started studying things. And I became quite educated through pretty much obsessive studying of numerology, symbology, cryptology, sacred geometry, psychology, philosophy, the occult, religion, theology, pretty much every ology there is, and then some. Learned about Freemasons, Illuminati, Skull and Bones, Rosicrucians, Bohemian Grove, all that stuff that you see that conspiracists talk about. I've learned so much about it, and now, come to find out, you know, it all just pretty much takes you in a big circle. You know, I just kept going round and round, and, you know, I realized that I learned more and more, but really, I wasn't getting anywhere. And about 2-3 years ago, and this is why it's taken me a long time to make this video, because it sounds kind of crazy, and I figure now I can't care. I can't be afraid of what people think. I'm going to tell you what happened. I'm going to tell you the gist of what happened. I was sitting in my room doing a sort of meditation, and all of a sudden I opened my eyes, and a red-orangish light floated into my room. And this light covered my body, and I began to cry hysterically while laughing hysterically. And while this was happening, I was having a conversation with this light inside my head, and what would take a year of a straight through conversation, you know, happened instantly in about, well, was there 20 minutes? I think the conversation was maybe about 5 minutes. And every question I've had over that 9 years was answered. You know, it's everything just made sense. And the next day, I noticed I'd listen to music where I'd see things on TV, and those symbols and everything, the numerology and everything I've studied over here, just everything sort of made sense in a way, a different kind of way. Everything sort of connected together. I was seeing things differently. It's very hard to explain. It just, everything made sense. You know, when I'd see a pyramid, I'd see the pyramid, I'd see three, I'd see past, present, future, being three, past, the present, the future, I'd see three, I'd see the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, I'd see everything just, I saw symbols and shape, everything just sort of clicked to me in a weird way. I guess today in the New Age religion, what people call the New Age religion, it's what they would call, I guess, the awakening or an awakening. Or Buddhists would call it an enlightenment. And this is what happened to me. And ever since, even though all my questions were answered, I began to have more questions because the human mind is never content. We get something, we always seem to want more and more and more. Even once we get that thing, we want more. It's never enough. So even though everything was answered, I was good for a few days, and it's like, yeah, but that was answered, but then what does that mean as far as this? You know, it's like when people would say, well, in the beginning there was God. God created the heavens and the earth. Okay? Well, if God created the heavens and earth, and in the beginning there was God, where did God come from if he was there in the beginning? You know, it's like it's never enough. We always got to have more. You know, it's not enough to know God was there in the beginning. We got to know, okay, if God was there in the beginning, where did he come from? We can't just say God is just. Because then we got to say, well, God is just what? You know, it's never enough. So I began understanding things in a certain way due to this strange light. It also had a conversation with me, told me it had many names and so on. I am not going to get too much into that. I'm going to tell you and teach you a little bit about what I learned. You can either accept it or not. It's up to you. It's just my experience and what I've come to realize and learn. There are... I'm a little nervous. This is my first video. And, you know, my family's going to be able to see it, so... kind of put myself out there, so don't mind me if I'm a little nervous. I learned so much, and I've always wanted to make a video, and I've never really knew how to do it, because in the olden days, when there would be, and I'm not saying I'm a prophet by any means, but in the olden days, prophets were teachers, which is what I'm trying to do, but in the olden days, when someone would declare themselves to be a prophet, the first thing that would happen is, you know, people would gather around, come listen to them, teach and prophesize and whatnot, give revelation. The people would look for something that they said to be contradictory. They'd look for something to contradict something they've said earlier. Well, you said this, but just a little while ago you said this. That don't make any sense. And this is why I've always been afraid to make a video, because when it comes to spiritualism and meaning of life and things of that nature, it's easy for one to contradict itself. Because it's not always one or the other. When it comes to spiritualism, it's more complicated than that. And the human mind tends to think in opposition as a duality. You know, we have that choice. It's one or the other. There's never a third or a fourth option. With every single momentary decision. It's this or that is what it usually comes down to. There's no all of the above, or it's always this or that. And that's the dual mind that we tend to think with, our left brain, our right brain way of thinking. And when talking about spiritualism, it's not always that easy. It's more complicated than that. So I've been hesitant to make a video because it's easy to contradict even what I say. I might say something and then say something later on that is different than what I said. But that's because it can be both things. I can say one thing that's opposite of something else, and they're total opposites and contradict each other. But they can also both be true. And both not be true. It's all perspective and how you view it. So I'm not telling you what to believe. I'm just here to tell you my experiences. So that being said, I'm going to talk about a few things. And I'm just going to kind of roll with it. A little nervous, so bear with me. To believe in something. You can believe in something that is not true and something that is true. Okay, you can believe in something that's false and something that's true. Okay, I can believe that this shirt is black, but it's white. I have the right to do that. You can believe in something that's true or not true. I can believe this shirt is white. That's true. I can believe it's black. It's not true, but it's still what I believe. You understand what I'm saying? Now, faith is the belief in something without proof. Okay? Faith, I'll say it again, faith is believing in something without any proof. Okay? So, you can believe. So, I have faith that this shirt was made in Japan. Let's say there's no tags on it or anything. I have faith that this shirt was originally made in Japan and that it's black. Okay? That's true. You can do that. I have faith in a belief. It's not a true belief, because obviously the shirt's white, it's not black. I can also have faith that the shirt was made in Japan and that it's white, and it is white. So faith is a belief, whether it be true or false, without any proof. See? I have no proof of where it was made. I just have faith that it was from Japan. You understand? That's kind of a view on faith. And then there's knowing. Knowing is a very powerful word. To know something is a proof. It's a truth and it's a proof. I forget who said the saying when they were asked, some philosopher, how do you know you exist? And the person said, well, I think, therefore I am. I don't know who I'm quoting. It's somebody, but I read a while back. But I think, therefore I am. You know, how do you know you exist? I think, therefore I am. Well, I can sit right here, not think a single thing, and still know I'm existing. So I'm not sure I believe that. To know something is almost indefinite. And what is it we truly know? Do we even really know we exist? There's so many different theories out there. You got Flat Earth Society. You've got whether we've really been to the moon or not. Extraterrestrials. All these things on religion. What do we really know? I mean, do we really even know we exist? Are we in some type of matrix? Is that possible? Yes, I stand true to the knowing that anything really is possible, at least in some way, shape, or form, even if somewhat illiteral or not literal meaning. Something can be taken, which I believe is how part of the Bible is pretty much written. I believe there's many truths in it. I believe there's many things that just aren't true. Okay. It was Socrates that said, the only truth in knowing is knowing that you know nothing. And I stand by it. The only truth in knowing is knowing that we know nothing. And really, that is the only truth in knowing. That's why everything I teach you or tell you is really based on perspective. I can tell you all about my experience and how real it was, and it was real. most real, you know. It was real, but it was real to me. You can't experience it because I'm the one that had it. And you can't know what I'm telling you is real. Because it's something that happened to me based on my perspective. I can't even know it was real because there's other things that can disprove it. If you can disprove something or give theories about how it's not real, you can't know it was real. Even in my heart, I know it was real. Which, in my heart, I feel that it was real. But all I can say is I feel it was real. I can't say I know it was. Okay? I had a spiritual experience, and I feel that it was very real. Do I know? It could have been hallucinating. It could have been, you know. But something happened to me after it. I've been changing, and something is going on. And I'm going to teach you a little bit about what I've learned. Take what you want from it. Believe what you want from it. It's up to you. All right. Religion. What is it? The three things you shouldn't talk about? Religion, politics, and forget the other one. The hardest thing to do is make a video on religion, because you're either going to offend a lot of people, or, you know. Religion is such a touchy subject. I'm going to tell you about what I've come to learn about religion and how I feel about it. Not what I know about it, how I feel about it. All right. We tend to focus so much externally when it comes to what we call God. I call it the source, creator or the source. I don't like to use the word God. I'm gonna use the word God so that majority of you can grasp the concept, but I find the word source or creator more authentic. But I'm going to use the word God. We all look at God and view God from an external view. Okay? We pick up the Bible, and I'm going to use Christianity most often because it's what I've learned most about, but I've studied most religions, you know, the main religions, Hinduism, Muslim, Jewish, Buddhism, Christianity and Buddhism are two that I like to focus on the most, and Jewish, I guess. We look externally for it. Many people will say, they'll look at the Bible and they'll say, this is the written word of God. No, it's the written word of men. It is not the written word of God, it's the written word of men. Now, when you look for answers, look in your heart. Feel if it feels true to you. This is something we've forgotten to do over the time. We've had the answers all along. Everything we need to know for any answer. We don't need to go to school for it. We don't need to look on the internet for it. Everything we need to know is inside us. It really is. We can feel what's true and what's not. We just forgot how to do it. And if we didn't forget, we just don't listen to it. Because society tells us to do something else. Okay? Most of the times you can feel whether something's true. But you don't listen. You go the other way. It's that duality, that opposition, that left brain, right brain, male, female. Okay? It's the good angel and the bad angel, you know, on one shoulder. That's where a lot of these, illustrations came from, you know, the good angel, bad angel. It's the duality of life. See, what you need to do is stop thinking here and start thinking here, okay? Feel what you know. Feel if something's true. And once you start to do this, you can usually spot a lie a mile away before anyone else, but you can just instantly, by listening here first. Listen here first, and then process it here. But let it brew here for a while before you send it here. Don't learn to not talk so much without feeling. You know what people say, think before you talk, feel before you talk. And you'll find your words are more enlightened, they're more truthful. People have forgotten how to do this. You know, if you think everything, you're thinking with that duality mind. Everything from the heart, there's only one place it can come from. Feeling is all one. It's one heart. There's no left brain, right brain to the heart. It's all one. Okay. That's why it's got to come from here first. And you think it through and process it up here. People have gotten so messed up with religion over the past few thousand years. I guess, who can say how far it goes back? You know, you got Muslim, Jewish, and Christian religion all coming from the same scriptures in the same book, the King James Bible. Okay? I believe, I mean, don't quote me on everything I say, but because some of what I've learned is a little shit, but I believe even Muslim testament, they follow the old religion, or the Old Testament. They just don't believe the New Testament is Jesus, and that was coming. They believe Muhammad was, and that was, 1,400 years ago, something like that. Don't quote me. But you got these three religions. Let's even forget the Muslim, you know, let's just go with Jewish, you know. You got two different religions. They think the Messiah hasn't come yet, you know, for the first time, and the Christians believe they're still waiting for the second time, and all these different contradictions. You look at how much it's divided. See, this is what happens when you search for God externally. Excuse me. You get nothing but division. Okay. You got Jewish, Christian. We're going to focus on that. There's two. And then you got Old Testament and New Testament. Jewish, they follow the first, the Old Testament. And then the second, the New Testament, they don't agree with. Okay? So much. Or at all, I'm not sure. But, you know, there's a division right there. All in the same book. And that's not even including Muslim. Technically, there's three or more. Okay? Then you got this one book with two religions, or three, or more, on two sections, old and new, which is split into 66 other books of testimonies that are not the written word of God, which are written word of man. Testimonies of what they call God. I'm here to tell you the word God even doesn't, it means so many different things. You know, there's the word Elohim in the Bible. Benahe Elohim. Which translates those who from which the sky came. Now, that could, extraterrestrials, that could be anything. We look at old island tribes. I think it was Hawaii or many island tribes. Back in World War II, and other old wars, 30s, 40s, 50s, we'd come over in helicopters before they even seen white men or whatever, and we'd come to these islands, and they'd worship us as gods because we came in planes. They thought we came from the stars. So what they'd do is they'd build planes out of wood and runways with sort of, they made their torches, and they'd have the runways lit up, and they'd stare at the sky, because we'd bring food. When we come to these islands, we'd bring food and give them food and stuff. So they kind of worshipped us. And you notice this trend follows throughout time. It's very well, we could have misinterpreted God as being something else. I mean, the very word in the Bible, I think it's actually written in the Bible, don't quote me, I think it's written in the Bible once, the word actualized, Elohim. I believe it's in there, actually written that way. But that's what the word, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek, it translates to. Benahi Elohim. B-E-H-A Elohim. Behai Elohim. If I got a little bit of that mistranslated, sorry, but the basis of what I'm trying to tell you is true. My truth, anyway. Okay. And that means those who from which this guy came. Those. Being plural, not singular. So, you look at the story in Ezekiel, in the first chapter of Ezekiel, there's a story about the whirlwinds and God coming down from the heavens, and he came in circular wheels or discs. This sounds like UFOs, how we view UFOs. They come in circular wheels. And four beings emitted from it. One had the face of I don't remember what they were, of an eagle, one of a goat, and two others. And there's four beings with animal-like features. One of them had the face of a man. And the other three were mammal or animal-looking faces. But they had the bodies of men. Sounds like extraterrestrials to me. Now, I'm not telling you to believe in extraterrestrials. Because, what did I say? The only truth in knowing is knowing we know nothing. I'm just saying, people don't have to think that because you believe in extraterrestrials that God doesn't exist, okay? Life's too amazing, too miraculous to think that something didn't create at all, okay? I'm just saying, it would be boring if they didn't, okay? The Civil Rights Movement, 50s, 60s, okay? I mean, how long have African Americans in the United States been fighting for civil rights? And even though they've gotten those rights, they're still treated unfairly by white supremacists, people in positions of authority, cops, judges, that just have beliefs passed down from their fathers and mothers. If we can't get over such a thing as black and white, or Mexican, Chinese, you know, simple race things. How are we supposed to accept a new species or a species from another planet? Or a distant ancestor that's humanoid that actually played a part in our evolution or the evolution of man? assuming that any of these things happened. We have to grow. And everyone talks about this expansion of consciousness, of mind. I believe there is something going on. I had experience, so I think there is something going on. I believe something's going on, but a belief can be true or false. Do I know? No. I don't know that there's some type of alignment of the planets, solar equinox, every 30,000 years, where we enter a new age every 2,160 years. I don't know if any of that's true. You know, a lot of this has started too with the 2012 Mayan calendar. A lot of people started paying attention to stuff like this. 60s played a big part in it, you know. This is the age of Aquarius, the age of Aquarius. Everyone's been talking about this new age stuff for a long time too. I don't know if that's it. What I do know is there is an expansion of evolution on a type of level. This I know because it's proven. It's a proven truth. And this evolution is happening quickly. There's two types of evolution that I know about. There's a DNA-based evolution, which from the best we think or believe happens over periods of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of years. And it's a very slow process. Then there's what's called a mimical evolution. Okay? Or it's something like that, mimic evolution, mimical. I'm just going to call it a mimical evolution. It's where someone copies something, or something, because they've tested this on monkeys, copies something which helps it to evolve, which spreads it to others, which they copy. Okay? And an example of this would be like a person that didn't know nothing about sports. Okay? This person wouldn't have known anything about sports, except for the fact that his dad was big into sports. So by watching his dad be big into sports, that person, that child, grew up to know about sports. This is the kind of basic concept of the mimical evolutionary theory. Okay? And this is true. This is happening. Now, you take that effect, okay, and you just multiply it by infinity. Because we have something now called the internet. And when did the internet take off? Okay, 80s. It was kind of crappy. You had the old Apple computers, you know, or playing Oregon Trail on it and whatnot. Not much you can do there. You can't research stuff really that easy. If you can, it's very limited. But the 90s and then the late 90s and then the 2000s. Between the 90s and the 2000s, now in the 21st century, the past 20 years, a rapid change is happening that we know the mimical evolutionary process is a big part of taking of why it's happening. Because now we have access to anything at any time. You want to get a degree, you want to learn how to take an engine apart on a car, boom, you go on Google, you research it, it's as simple as that. You don't have to go down, talk to someone who knows someone who might have a friend that, you don't have to work like it. It's all right there at your fingertips, anything you want to learn about. So everything's sort of combining at a level. It's like taking every, you know, special gift from everyone that knows anything about it, anything, putting it together on the web and having access to it. It's like combining all the intellectual and conscious knowledge of everyone in the world and putting it into one. And isn't that what it's all about? Isn't that how we view God as one, as monotheistic? Okay, we view him as the one source of everything, the beginning and the end, the all it is, the something that's inside of something that's inside of something that's at the top of it and at the bottom of it, which comes together, you know, top all around to make that circle, the whole, that source, that God. And that's what's sort of happening. We're evolving through the internet. That I know. Okay. Whether something celestial, lining of the planets is happening, I can't say because I don't know. I have theories. I have beliefs. Whether they're true or false, I don't know. I don't want to tell you about too much about what I believe, because like I said, a belief can be true or false. I want to tell you about what I know, okay? That's what I want to focus on, okay? So you can learn more from what you know than what someone believes. And then it's as simple as a choice. What you're used to doing already, a choice. Left or right, up or down, high or low, God or the devil. You know, you're used to that duality. So that's why I want to make it simple. You either accept what I know, the knowing that I have, or you don't. Mind you, everything I'm going to say right now ain't a knowing. A lot of it's beliefs. But I will tell you whether it's a belief, a hope, or a knowing. And it's simple with the knowing. You simply accept what I know and take it as what you now know, or you don't. Okay? I know this is happening. Now, my cigarette went out. Okay. This is rapidly and very fast. It's changing society and evolving people, not on a genetic level, but on, I don't know what you want to call it, on a societal level, as a society, as a world, as a one, bringing all people to one. And that's what it's all about. You know, a lot of Masonic beliefs talk about this one world government, one world banking system, and you know, a lot of people fear that. And maybe they should, because if that's used for the wrong reasons, you know, it could be bad. But it can also be good. They talk about one. Okay? That's one of the things with the occult. You know, you have religion and then you got the occult. And they always think, oh, it's one or the other. But, you know there's a Masonic center right next to the Roman Catholic Church. That's that duality that always makes us think it's this or it's that. And a lot of Masons will always say, oh, you know, we're Christian based, you know, religion, but you can be of any religion. You know, all they want you to believe in is a higher power. And they'll say you can have any god or any faith, it don't matter. And many of the lodges that are Christian based will say this thing, like, there's always an open Bible in our lodge, and they'll say, you know, I don't know what that means. They tend to speak and say things, and the way I do, I see things symbolically and numerically. It's weird. They'll say there's an open Bible in every lodge. You know, you just want to ask them, well, is there ever a closed one in the lodge? You know, why is it always got to be open? What's with this? What's with all the code? You know, it's, they're a different bunch of people. But they're very smart. I'll tell you that. They know things. They're what? I'm not even going to theorize on what, but we got to stop looking as one's the bad, one's the good. You know, it's funny. They talk about uniting and bringing everything together as one. And then, you know, you see the church. I'm just going to use the church as an example. And you look at all the dividing of it, you know, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, all based on the same King James Bible, all the same scriptures in that in one book. It's out of 66 books with four main gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. It's all these divisions in it, you know. And then you look at religion itself, and it's, what was it, 30 to 40,000 different religions in the world. 30 to 40,000 different religions in the world. 1,000. Now, you look at, oh, sorry, I said that wrong. I take that back. That's how many different denominations there are for Christianity. I'm sorry. There is, what is it? I might be getting my numbers mixed up here. Three to 4,000 different religions in the world? Is that how it is? 3 to 4,000 religions in the world? Yes, I think that's what it is. 3 to 4,000 religions in the world. Different types of religions in the world. But out of Christianity alone, this is where I got it mixed up. Christianity alone, there's between 30,000 to 40,000 different denominations for just Christianity alone. It's like, holy shit. Divide, divide, divide. God is outside yourself. It's outside. Repent. You know? Recognize the sin. Seek forgiveness. Repent for your sin. All these restrictions and things you're supposed to do, all to live what's natural inside one to do. You know, you can't even masturbate without it being a sin. So many things in there that are just nonsense. If you really look inside yourself, can't eat shellfish. You can stone, and these aren't the exact words, but more or less. I mean, it might actually sound nicer the way I'm saying it. You can, if your kid disobeys you, you can stone them to death. If your wife has an affair on you, you have the right to kill her. Slavery is okay. I don't want to get too much into the semantics of it, because I can bring up certain things about this and that, and then you'll have someone who's a diehard Christian on the other end claiming this and that, and they're going to pull out other sections of the Bible to try and go against what I'm saying. They're going to say things, oh, well, slavery, that was the Old Testament. That was before, you know, the New Testament came. Which, it's like, isn't this the same God? But at the same time, they're going to say, no, well, that was the culminate, that for a different age of a different time, the laws had to be changed. And that's when Christ came along. And they're going to say, all these things, you know, your priest or your preacher will talk about how falling from God and you'll come, you know, it'll happen from time to time, and then, you know, you come back into God's grace, or you're baptized to wash away your sins. I just get sick, because they do this, you know, and then they want the money from you, and all this stuff, and God can save you from drug addiction, critical illness, from anything. And it makes me sad, because, you know, everyone's still waiting for the second coming Christ or whatever, you know, your religion may be. And here's the thing, I don't want to make too much fun of religion, because there is good in religion. It's just we've fallen so far from its true grace that it's sad and it's sickening. You know, I admire people like Bill Murr, you know, people that make fun of religion, but at the same time, you know, you shouldn't make fun of it, because you offend people, and that's not what I'm trying to do. There is good in religion. It's just, if you're gonna follow something and take something and hold it as your own, research it, learn about it. You see, religion goes back thousands of years. It goes back to paganism. Even before that, it goes back to mysticism, okay? You see those guys on YouTube videos, you're wearing white, they got big beards. They may not be the mystics that they were back then. I believe they're a little wiser back then. I consider Buddha kind of sort of a mystic, but Buddhism kind of formed into its own religion. Christianity goes thousands of years back. Christ is the temple, it's the house, and the house is the body. See, mysticism turned into Christianity. Christianity formed its a sort of universalized religion type thing. When it turned from mysticism and evolved into Christianity, out of that came Gnosticism, okay? And then there was Gnostic Christians. And I believe Gnostic Christians is more of what people call these messiahs, prophets and apostles of the past, were trying to say, okay? Jesus himself said salvation lies within, okay? It's within you. And that's what the Gnostics believe. They believe that God is within you. Cigarette went out again. God is in within each and every one of you. And the problem is we started looking outside ourselves for God. It's in the book. It's the written word of God. It's written by people. We know this. We started lying to ourselves, and the church was lying to us. 300 A.D., Constantine formed together a group of all the wisest, considered holy Christians of that time, and brought them together to form together the Bible, okay? And don't mind me if my dates and things are a little off. You know, I'm trying to throw together all that I've learned, and some of them might be a little... the gist of it, I'm trying to keep intact. You know, if it wasn't 300, or it might have been 400 years, you know? So don't quote me on my dates and stuff. But I believe it was 300 AD Constantine formed together a group of so many people to form the Bible and decide what scriptures were going to be in and what weren't, what books were going to be in and what weren't. A lot of, I believe, influential books got left out, like Book of Jubilee, my favorite, the Book of Enoch, which, I don't quote me, was like the sun the grandfather, or the father or the grandfather of Noah, I believe. Either that, or it was Noah's son's son. I don't know. It was somewhere within a few generations of Noah's family. It was his son's son, or his father's, or grandpa father was one of them. Book of Enoch is very influential because it talks about Enoch taking a trip to heaven. And it talks about all these different creatures, what we would call angels. And we describe angels now as, you know, being of light and having wings. And but they're described differently in the Book of Enoch. Some do have wings, but they're described more as how we would view extraterrestrials, I guess. And you gotta remember, the word heaven can have many views. The heavens has always been known as the sky out there in the stars, you know, the universe, multiverse, whatever you want to call it, other dimensions. So many different views on it, but a lot of good books got left out so that they could have a centralized view on religion. And there's actually a council that formed. I don't know what year it was, 1600s, 1300s. I don't know. I just remember reading about it, that it took place on Gnosticism, and how they pretty much, I believe, banned it for the most part, because the form church didn't want people viewing Christianity as proclaiming themselves as gods in themselves. People doing that. You know, Jesus had the whole Last Supper thing, you know, the breaking of the bread and the wine. This is my blood, this is my body. There's a message in there. You know, we do communion, it's a message. It's something inside of something inside of something, living inside of Jesus's light. There's always a light inside of a light. I ain't gonna get too much into that. But it's symbolic. Jesus is trying to say that we're all connected. This is my body, this is my blood, eat of it, remember this, and think of me. It's symbolic for saying we're all part of it. You look in science, every atom, an atom can be split apart, put at opposite ends of the world. This has been proven through science. And that other half will always know where the other one, or a particle will always know where the other half is. And so on and so on. And we're all made out of atoms, particles, nucleuses, neutrons, electrons. And knowing that if you split one in half and put it anywhere opposite ends of the universe, it always knows where that other thing, that's where intuition and I believe a lot of other things come into play, but I ain't going to go too deep into that. But understanding that, and understanding what's also been proving, that an atom is made out of 99.99% of empty space, And it's like 0.00000000001%, I think I got that right, of, which isn't very much, of energy or light says a lot too. And it's that vibrating of the particles of that 1% of the actual part that is solid, that 0.000 whatever 1% is the only part of us that's solid. Technically, this is how Sid and the proofs of this discovery is, technically you should be able to take all the physical mass, all the mass that should be actually physical out of every single person, out of the 0.000 whatever 1 that's physical in it, of every person in the world, and it should fit inside of a sugar cube. Why doesn't it? Well, because a lot of mysteries that I ain't gonna get too much into, but we're energy particles, atoms, vibrating at a certain resonance, frequency, and wavelength, with empty space in between those particles and atoms. Yeah, because we're mostly empty space. Vibrating so fast at such a high frequency and resonancy that gives us our physicality, and that's how physicality happens. So you can go into that whole hologram thing theory and conspiracy theory and matrix theory, and technically, yeah, it is true. Doesn't mean we're not physical and whatever. And this is where the whole thing I told you about contradiction comes into play, because we are physical and we are not physical at the same time. Yes, you can be physical and not physical at the same time, and that's what we are. That's what all matter is. It's physical and it's not physical, except for the part that's actually fully physical, which is the tiny part in us that's, I don't know which part, particle, I think is, but it's such a small amount of it that's, don't quote me on that, the particle part of it, but the 99.99% of empty space is true. So what does that tell us? And here's where it gets deep. We are nowhere. Are we on Earth? Where are we? Matrix, this, that. The truth is, we are nowhere. Because we are 99.99% empty space. Oh, but what about that 0.00000001% that is actually physical, which vibrates and makes the rest of the empty space between physical? Well, okay, so we're not totally empty space. So we're a very itty-bitty tiny amount of somewhere. Not going to go into where, we'll just stick with somewhere, because to explain where gets even deeper. So here's the deep part. We are nowhere and everywhere at the same time. How are we everywhere? Well, because all atoms are connected throughout the universe. All atoms. We're all connected. We are nowhere and everywhere at the same time. The light and the empty space, which is the dark. We are the light and the dark. The wavelength in between of the empty space, which creates physicality. We are the beginning and the end. You see where I'm going with this? We are God. I'm not trying to self-proclaim myself as God, Messiah, the second coming of Christ, or like you see a lot of these, I hate to call them whack jobs, but I think their ego got a little bit too carried away. I say this without pride, without ego. We are God. I am God. You are gods. This wall is God. This bed is God. They have atoms. These atoms are all connected. We are all God. And these are where the teachings in the Bible kind of, it's more like a guidebook. They teach you things. Like all religions have something. They're meant to teach you these things. It's just, it's been used so far out of context. It's ridiculous. You can't understand the true meaning of Christianity going back thousands of years, way before Christ. There's been so many others who have tried teaching the word of Christ. Remember, Christ isn't, when I say Christ, I don't mean Jesus. I mean the Christian Christ teachings, the original throughout time Christ religion. Being house, temple, God, right here. This is where it originated. This is what it meant, what they were talking about. This is the Christ. This is the house. This is the temple. And that's what Christianity meant, the original teachings. And that's all Christ was trying to say. Just his words. It was confusing to people for some. And plus, I believe, some intentionally mistranslations. It was, and things he said were used out of context. He may have been talking about something at one time, which meant something different another time. And how he said it got switched around, referring to two different subjects to what he said. And the translations back then to now, around, no one knows whether Jesus spoke Hebrew or Aramaic or even Greek, part of Greek. We don't know, but these were the three religions around that time that we believe were involved greatly in the translations and interpretations of the scriptures that were found from these prophets and messiahs and what have you around Christ's time. They translated what we call his word. And what we would call something back then, let's just use Hebrew for example, that same word used today, translated correctly, might even mean something different than it meant back then. This happens a lot too. And you get that with the out of context and then the mistranslations. And I think the first book that they found was the book of, I forget which book out of the Bible it was, but I think the earliest that scripture that they had from one of the books was written 60 years, I believe it was 60 years after Christ's death, so 60 AD, and that's the earliest translation and view of, you know, things that took place and what happened, and everything else is after that. I mean, they may have earlier ones in the Vatican hidden in their vault or whatever, I don't know. But I mean, from what I understand, don't quote me, that's the earliest one they have. And you get all these mistranslations of things, prophets, Messiah, you know, Jesus and the Father and whatnot, of what they said. And it's, you gotta take it with a grain of salt. And you gotta do this with every religion. The ritualistic practices like the communion and confession and all these things you gotta do, it's all, to me, that a lot of it's, with all religions, a lot of it's nonsense. There are certain things, I have a great respect for Buddhism, because with Buddhism, I've learned a lot of things through meditation and understanding of Buddhist teachings. Minding you, Buddhist teachings, a lot of what Buddha said was the same as the things Jesus said, you know, where Jesus said, turn the other cheek. Buddha might have said something like, love one another instead of hate or something. That's not what he said, but you know, they would say the same things, just differently. And you get that a lot with all the religions, not all of them maybe, but most of them, especially the major ones, Hinduism, Muslim, Buddhism, Jewish, Christian, so on, Aramaic, or not Aramaic, but you know, all the other religions, the main ones. And with Hinduism, you get Shiva, and you've got Krishna. Krishna was the beginning of and life and resurrection and all these good things. And then you got Shiva, who was the destroyer and this and that. So you got, and the end, and you know, so Krishna was the alpha. Shiva was the omega, and you got all these theories, you know, you see the duality, the opposition, and people fight over what's the right religion, what's the wrong religion. And a lot of times people just take a religion because it's what they were grown up to believe. Or they've had a tragedy when they were a child. They were molested, or they were... something really bad happened to them. Raped or something, you know. Something bad happened to them and they turned them to religion. And they needed that. And that's understandable, but... I really want people to start learning where the religion came from and that it's not based around one person like Jesus. Do I think Jesus existed? Yes. Do I think he was extraordinary? Yes, I do. Do I know he existed? No. I don't know. It's like I don't know any of the other ones of any religions did. I think he did. It would make sense to have all those books and... scriptures and what's been passed along for so long, and to not have even Jesus of Nazareth even have existed, I really strongly think they did. But he was just trying to teach you. I believe he was trying to teach you something that has been passed along for a long time. There has been, I believe, 47 different that I know of, that I've looked at, 47 different, what I would call Christian prophets, teachers, guides, like Jesus. They didn't call him Messiah. Sometimes they did. A lot of times they were just viewed as a teacher. You know, they knew better at the time, I think, before religion got so tangled up. They would call themselves Christians. Don't quote me on which ones. I believe Apollo, Murdoch, Hermes, Sun God, even extraterrestrial based one, Inky, whatever. There's tons of them that were considered to be prophet like. Guide teachers. Some of them, many of them, were even kings. They were just trying to show you a way. Okay. We also talk about polytheistic views and monotheistic views. Okay, the belief in one god or many gods. Okay, and we have this idea that nowadays we believe there's one god, and pretty much everyone fights over which religion and which god that is. And we have this idea that long ago they believed in many gods and they didn't have a monotheistic view. That's not true. They each had their gods for the areas that they were from. Whatever culture they had, you know, whatever time they were, you know, it was, they had their gods. Okay? Sometimes many gods. You look at the Greek gods, you know, you got Zeus, Poseidon, Hades, and all the other. They had it like that, but they also had many where there was just for one area, one tribe, that doesn't really interact with anything else because there's nothing close by. They had one god. And there was a lot of times where just one god. To them, that was it. There was the one god. But then you look at long ago, from a worldwide perspective, they didn't have internet. There was that one god, everyone, you know, there couldn't have been no fighting over religion because certain areas didn't interact. And the ones that did, they would fight over God and who was God, and there'd be temples built in those gods' names. But it doesn't mean there was it was polytheistic, that there was many, many gods. It just means that everyone had their own view on who God was, just like today. You know, but yet, what do we do with that? Today, we separate it, and we add another division, and say, oh, well, back then, it was polytheistic, and now we realize there's one God, and now we're better. We haven't evolved that much today than we have back then. But we're going to start evolving, because we realize that we've been doing the same thing then that we're doing now. We all have our own gods, and we all fight over it, and it causes war, it causes division. Then you look at the occult, who claim one world government, one world banking, but then... from a religious view, if you're a Christian looking at the Masons or the Illuminati, then you start thinking, oh, well, you know, they want one world government, one world banking. They want control over everyone. It's all about control. And it's like, you know, the devils, Freemasons are devils. So, but yet, they got a Masonic Center next to the church. They even got a telescope called the Lucifer, which sees in the universe through a, what is that? That red spectrum, that ultraviolet or whatever it is, that red, I forget what it's called. I can't think of it. I'm having a brain fart. But they have a telescope that can see things out there that we can't see through normal telescopes because it's in that different spectrum, that red like spectrum or whatever it is, or ultraviolet. It's called the Lucifer. It's at the Vatican. And then you got the Masonic Center. So it seems like they're working together pretty well. It almost seems like the church divides the people, being that there's 3,000 to 4,000 different religions. There's 30,000 to 40,000 different denominations for Christianity. So while they're dividing the people, the cult brainwashes them through projects like, you know, Monarch, or you hear of all these brainwashing, and believing brainwashing is very possible. We're told how to look, how to act, how to whatever through the billboards and everyday life, how to dress, how to, you know. So as they divide them, the church and religion, the occult entertains us and slowly brainwashes us through everything we see in our reality and tells us what to believe and how to think and how to act. But for a Christian, you know, it's the devil inside there, and is they want you to think it's one or the other. It's all, they're all the same. That's why they say there's an open Bible. And a lot of Masons and that become deacons and priests themselves because it's all the same thing. They divide, they brainwash. That's how I see it. Now, does that mean that there ain't good things in each one? Yes, there is, but you got to dig deep to find them. The good things that existed in religion and that existed in, I think, maybe Buddhism aside and some other religions, but especially Christianity, Catholic, you know, the Catholic Church, and Freemasons. the good things have come and went with them, I think. It's still there. I mean, this is how I see it. There's good and bad in everything and everyone. That's the duality, the only truth to duality. It's not heaven or hell. There's good and bad in everything and everyone. Even God himself. If everything falls back to one point, one tip of the mountain, all tracing back to one solid point in existence, of which is existent throughout all existence in some way, shape, or form, one source of all creation, it's good and it's bad. Because life can't exist without both. Now, if you want to get Christian on it, if God created the devil, why did he create the devil if he's omnipotent? If he knew the devil was going to be bad, because God knows all things, why did he do it? Because how can we know what's good if we don't know what's bad? How can God be perfect and all it is, and the all-creator and all-knowing and all-perfect, if there isn't something that's the opposite of that? See, this is just conceptual. It's just the way of thinking. It doesn't mean that there's some all source. Doesn't mean there isn't. I think there is. Pretty sure there is, actually. But I don't want to go into my beliefs so much as what I know. Okay? We have to start listening to what we know is true. What we know is true. And stop searching for God outside ourselves. Stop going to church every Sunday and giving your money to something that you don't need to do. See, God didn't just create the heavens and the earth. God became the heavens and the earth. God is in everyone and everything. You just have to see it. So often people, I fell from God. I haven't been to church in a while. I fell away from God for a while. But, you know, I found my way back. And people have all these stories. And the reason you fall away from it is because something in your heart tells you it ain't true and it don't matter. And you start wanting to experience things that are called sins. Like, you know, whatever it might be. You know, masturbation's a sin. All these things that we enjoy doing are sins. Gluttony's sin. Eating too much. It's like they just want to. It's about control for them. Christianity, and not all of it, but the majority of it, and especially today, and Masonry. Not all of it, but majority of it today has become about control. Mason's not so much back in. Way back when, Illuminati, wasn't always a part of Masonry. I think it was, when did the Declaration of Independence, 1776, 77, I think 1776, around that time, somewhere in the 1700s, the Catholic Church banned Illuminati because they saw them as becoming too powerful, and they forged into Masonry. Masonry used to be about structured geometry and many other things. I consider it so much on a spiritual level, but when you understand everything as a whole, it is and it isn't. Spirituality is a little bit of everything. It is geometry. It is a culmination of sacred geometry, shapes, circles inside of circles, circle of tree of life, fruit of life, Fibonacci, all these things. You know, Illuminati forged in. They didn't always have the best intentions, and they didn't get along with the church, and they were kind of pissed. many of them got killed, and it's been a war going on, a feud for thousands of years. And I'm gonna tell you this too: Masonry and Illuminati, and many other cults, but especially or occults, but especially them. They don't go, but no matter what you're told, they don't go back to George Washington or, you know, whatever, Benjamin Franklin. They'll try and tell you that, like it's so surprising they've been around for, you know, a couple or a few hundred years. They go back thousands of years. They go back to the Egyptians, the pyramids being built. They go back, and that's just what I strongly believe, okay, that they go back that far. It's very well possible they could go back to the very beginning of our existence, of humanity, at least on this planet, assuming that there's, you know, humanoid life out there, too. You know, got the Lyran theories, and all existence created in Lyra. But we're just talking about here the very culmination of our existence as we have evolved today and have been evolved in this way. Since we went from whatever we went from, Homo sapien to Neanderthal or Neanderthal to Homo sapien to whatever we are now, I'm talking that's how long they exist. They've been, that's what I think. But what I strongly believe is that they've gone back to the Egyptian days, pyramid, 6,000, 9,000 years. This is what I'm pretty sure of. A lot of them have researched them thoroughly and obsessively. They go back a long way. From the checkered floors to the bell, to the compass and square and unfinished pyramid, all seeing eye, all these. I've researched these things and different theories about these things forever. And you see a lot of Egyptian symbolism in what they are. And I'm just saying there's good and bad in both things, religion and them. And it seems like they work together. And I feel like it's gotten to the point where we need, as a people, to evolve into one world. Not necessarily one world government, one world banking system, maybe as time goes on. But we got to be very careful doing this too. Because when we do this, the control factor that will come in from what we would call the elite, people above our people who, you know, the very small percentage that rule the world are going to try and use this culmination of a one world government, a one world system, banking system, and so on and so forth, as a way to control us in a lot, in a much easier way. We have to be careful doing this and manage to keep our freedoms as a world. But this is what does need to happen. I'm not a Freemason. I don't consider myself a follower of any religion particularly. I won't call myself a Christian. I won't call myself a mystic. I won't call myself a Buddhist. Although I do carry very strong Christian beliefs. I have a very strong Christian belief system. And Buddhist system. And mystic type system that I do use and hold strong to myself and is a big part in how I am and who I am and the way I teach and talk comes from mysticism, Christianity, and Buddhism. I'm talking early Christian, early Buddhist, well, even current Buddhist system. You can benefit from a lot of things from Buddhism currently. You can't benefit a lot from Christian teachings or practices or rituals, really. In today's day and age, you don't learn much from it. You can learn a lot from meditating and things that are still practiced in Buddhism. It can teach you a lot. It can help you reach what they would call enlightenment. I'm very appreciative for Buddhism. I'm very appreciative for Christian, from what I've learned from the where Christianity evolved from, though. And mystic teachings have taught me a lot as well. The reason people fall from grace or fall from God, what they call when you're a Christian or whatever, they'll say, "Oh, I fell from grace. But I came back to the Lord," and this and that. The reason you fall is because of fear. You didn't really fall. You came back out of fear. That's not so much about the fall. It's good to fall. Why you come back is fear, is it not? Do you not come back because, well, you know, I started doing this and that, and it was wrong. But I came back because I got arrested, so I came back to God, or, you know, my drug addiction, so I came back to God. Yeah, because you got caught, and, you know, we always come back because, as an excuse, you know, to get out of trouble, usually, or we come back to God because we're afraid of eternal damnation. If you have one question to ask yourself, whatever religion you believe, it's, does your God love unconditionally? Unconditionally. Because my God does. Because my God is inside myself. Know thyself. One of the true things that you'll find in at least Hinduism, Buddhism, and Christian. You'll see it early and new. It's one of the most important things you can know. Thyself. Knowing that, you can know everything. The more you know yourself, the more you can access universal knowledge of all types. Most important thing you can do is to know every aspect of yourself. And it's not as easy as just, well, I like this, I don't like this. You know, you gotta know yourself. You gotta know why you do the things you do. The bad things you do, what caused you and raised, where did it stem from, how you change it, and why would you even want to change it, and what causes you to be that way, and just, you have to really know yourself, and this is what I do when I meditate. I learn more about myself, why I did the things I did, so on and so forth. And this will bring you closer to God, knowing yourself. Well, how would knowing yourself bring you closer to God? Because you're God. God is in everything. It's in something that's inside something that's inside something that's inside something that is light, that is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I've explained all that to you. It's you. All those things are you. Your atoms, your light. Your light, your energy vibrating at a frequency. You're the empty space in between, therefore the beginning and the end. The light and the dark. You're everywhere and nowhere. These things are all you. Science, religion, and all the things that I put together that I've learned and experienced, spiritual experience I've had, has come to bring me to this one thing, this one knowing that God is you. God is me. It's you and me. It's everything. It's the floor. And everything else is something inside of something inside of something. Did you ever see one of those, like a movie, you know, the movie might take place in outer space, and they'll show something, you know, they'll show you backing out of Earth, you know, a camera view backing out of Earth, and you'll see all the squares and farmland and everything starting to come out of view, and then you see the blue, and you see the planet, the green, the blue, and it's backing up. Next thing you need to see is the solar system. You see the seven planets, then, you know, the moon, the Earth, and then it takes you out further out of that. Then you go into the galaxy, and it takes you out of the galaxy. And once it starts to take you out of the galaxy, those billions of planets and stars and whatnot all seem to be in this one big spiral for this one galaxy. And it might be white, because we're Milky Way and whatever galaxy. And then it'll show another one next to it that's red spiraling, and, you know, like the seven chakras, and then you see a red, an orange, a green, a blue, a violet, and then it takes you into, you know, and then those are all galaxies, and then instead those pull apart, and that takes you into one bigger type of spiral, and everything I've come to realize and learn is something inside of something. And generally, you know, you hear these words a lot in songs, and I've noticed it more and more. Words like sun, or light, or the fire, or whenever they talk about these things, they're very substantial, and they're usually not love songs. They sound like it. They're talking about God. They're talking about the universe, the meaning of life. I just caught these hints, and the people making these songs may not have even realized it, but there's always something inside of something, inside of something, inside of something. Where's the beginning and then? I don't know. But there's something inside of something that just keeps going. That's what we are. And that something is electricity and light when it comes down to it. The rest is empty space. Yes, we are mostly nothing. But that itty-bitty part that is that 0.0001 is... it's so amazing. And it's the realization of all these things that once you see it, once you... it's like, you know, the whole thing about people say finding Jesus, you know, okay, whatever. But once you have the experience I had, it's like hitting your knees. And just when that light came over me, I started laughing hysterically while crying hysterically. I guess that's the duality. It's just whatever. And I asked it, what is this feeling? And it said, this is love. And it said, this is everything. Okay, I get it. It's like one of those boxes. You take out the box, you open the box, there's another box inside, you take it out, you open that, there's another box. That's really what life is. It's something inside of something, inside of something, inside of something. Eternally, forever. That's the big secret of life, what I've come to know of life. And like I said, it's mine. You can accept it or not, or accept the other things I said. And not this. That's the knowing I've come to know. What happens when we die and this and that, I can go into that in another video. Don't go to Christianity or to a church, whatever the church may be, because remember there's 30 to 40,000 different denominations for Christianity. Don't go to a church because you're told by your parents that's what to believe. God's love is unconditional. Life is unconditional. He wants you to live it to the fullest. It loves you whether you do right or wrong. Can you really see God sending you to an eternal hell, fire, torment, being burned inside and out, torn apart, and tortured in some type of eternal damnation in hell for eternity, being that you are created in God's image, made in His likeness? I mean, can you really see yourself, you know, look at your kids, if you have kids. I mean, when your kid was born, did you ever say, would you look at your kid and say, even though he's covered in blood and whatever, would you look at your, you know, from being born, would you look at your kid and say, oh, this kid is sinful and unclean? You as a father, do you see yourself doing that? You think God would do that to you? We're born with sin. We are not born with sin. We're born of God. We're born gods. And anything else is a lie. It's not blasphemy to say it either. A father does not look at a kid and say he is full of sin and he is unclean and dirty. Maybe because he's got blood on him because he was just born, a child. But not in the way that we interpret it as born with sin, born unclean, and we need to repent our sins. And we need to acknowledge each one of our sins, ask forgiveness, and repent for those sins. Acknowledge, repent, and I forgot what the third one was. I'm getting too caught up, but I just get emotional. It makes me upset to think that that's how God is. That we have to do these, that He views us that way. I mean, we're to be put to death if we ate shellfish. It says that in the Old Testament. I'm not going to get into that, torn apart, because you can have diehard Christians come back at you and say, oh no, that's not what it meant. And slavery was okay back in that time. It was a different age. Every age, it was 2,160 years, and solar equinox and this and that, and there was, you know, Aries, and you go through the different stages, and you know, Christianity used to go be based off the paganist. It came from paganism, in a way. Paganism and mystic teachings were kind of